Feel free to chime in and to ask anything that you want to ask. And I'm going to start with this. Let's see if I can get it to, there we go, to the full screen. And that when we're talking about what's real and what's not, it is easy right now to go to artificial intelligence. And I think that's one of my big concerns right now with artificial intelligence, generative artificial intelligence, and what it can create, and the ease in which it can be used to create things that seem real. These are two examples from the New York Times that were both created by generative artificial intelligence. So it looks real, it sounds real. It's becoming harder and harder to make that determination. And I'll give you some examples of that in a minute about how you can kind of judge sometimes what's real and what's not. Are you seeing a foreign language at the bottom of your screen along with
Yep.
me?
Yes, we are.
Okay, let me turn that on. I think what I was doing was showing, I was demonstrating this for,
I think you're translating it into Greek.
yeah, I don't know what I was showing this feature for somebody a while back, and it, well, I'm sorry, it's not giving me, let me stop sharing for a minute. And let me fix that and I'll go back. There's a way that you can translate it. And I was showing that for somebody recently, and I apparently forgot to turn it off. So see. You know what? I think I may just have to go with it because now I'm not finding very
Yeah,
easily.
somebody said that it's too small, they can't read it anyway, so it's not a problem.
Yeah, I know, but it's kind of annoying. It's kind of annoying for me. I get it. Well, I'm not finding it very easily. So I'm going to go back and see if I can. What I may do is just share my screen and then not go to the presentation mode and see if that'll get rid of it. So it may be a little bit smaller, but you'll be able to see it without the Greek on it. All right. All right. So there are the people that were created with AI. But I want to back off that because that's apparent right now and is easy to focus on that and think that that's the main problem. Not necessarily. And I said that I would share some personal experiences. Well, I got email. Oh, this was in January, February. I don't remember. And then I've been getting it again. Oh, we would like to put you on the cover of this magazine. Look at the, you are somebody who is a leader in AI, and we would love to put you on the cover and look at all the benefits that you'd get. You're one of the top leaders in shaping artificial intelligence. You've get an your image will be on the cover. You'll have 8 full pages. Oh, and by the way, there'll be a nominal fee of $4,000 to do that. I looked up the magazine. I mean, I didn't know the magazine, but I think that's what you have to be thinking about all the time. This looks like a legitimate magazine. And when I started going into it, it's created in India, so or somewhere in Asia, so that it can, that it's not subject to some of the guidelines that we have or rules that we have in the United States. But this still happens. And you have to be aware of where you're getting information. What's the source of the information that you're getting? And making sure that even if it looks legitimate, you're doing some checking and just looking at, well, where is this coming from? Who's involved with it? One of the things that is important to pay attention to with this is something called sponsored content. And that's what that magazine really is. It's sponsored content. Now, in this case, this is from, I mean, this is from an advertising company. The sponsored content is everywhere. And this is from something called Active Campaign, which is an advertising company that's promoting the advertising. And they're promoting sponsored content like the one I showed you, as this is premium content, and it's wonderful because it looks like the rest of the environment. So it's wonderful for you as an advertiser. It builds credibility for you, and it's a great fit for everybody. I mean, we used to call this advertorial, that it's a combination. Editorial would be what we would produce for the news content, and advertising is what pays for it. And then when you blend it, you get advertorial. Well, now it's called sponsored content, and it's everywhere. This is a Wall Street Journal site. This is their video. And you, I mean, you have to pay attention to it, because this is, okay, waiting for generative AI future. Here's how to take action. If you look at things like presenting sponsor, this was content created by Oracle. The New York Times does this. It will say something like a paid post. Now, with the Times and with most other organizations, if they're reputable, it will not look exactly the same as the rest of the content. This has a different typeface, and it just has a different look than the rest of the material on the Times site. And yet, when you're looking at it, unless you're paying attention and seeing paid posts, it would be easy to fall into that trap and think, okay, this is a Times article. I mean, I'll run back here real quick. You can see the New York Times font that it uses, and that's different from what you see here. So if you're used to seeing things on a particular site and that changes, you want to look for something called either paid post, sponsored content. Here's another example from BuzzFeed. They just call it a brand publisher. All of that means is that this was content created by a company and is being posted on the site or published in the publication, the magazine, the newspaper, whatever it is. It looks like content for the site in many ways, but it was still produced by someone else, by the company. So it's not, it doesn't fall into that, the journalistic integrity that we would have, where we're not, the goal is to provide unbiased information, or as unbiased as it can be, rather than promoting a particular brand, a particular company, a particular product. On social media, the Federal Trade Commission has guidelines for influencers. I mean, that's a huge area right now, is social media influencers. People who are pitching a particular product or a lifestyle or all kinds of things, that they may get money from companies to sell the product or to say, oh, look at, I've been using this product for the last week and look at how it makes my skin glow. Or I've been driving this machine for, you know, the last month, and I just find that it's so enjoyable, things like that. There are disclosures for that. And that's for anything social media. If you're looking at something on YouTube, there is a requirement where someone will say, this is something that I received from the company, or I received payment, or that they gave this to me and asked me to do a review for it. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean that they're being dishonest about anything, but anybody should be providing that sort of documentation for you to tell you that, yes, I'm being paid to do this, or they gave me the product to review, or I am a representative of the company in some way. So that's one way to look for it, where when someone is on social media, on YouTube, on some of those sites like that, where they are saying that there is a financial relationship involved there. Another thing to keep in mind, though, and this is BuzzFeed, but I'll give you an example of the New York Times doing this too. They're saying, here we have 29 smart purchases that won't make your wallet shudder. Okay. And they're saying, well, we hope you love our recommendations. Some may have sent samples, but all were independently selected by our editors. Okay. I mean, there is some bias in that already. But BuzzFeed and its publishing partners may collect a share of sales or other compensation from the links on this page. That is a way that publishing companies are making money today, because online advertising has really dwindled for publications. It's really difficult for a lot of publications to draw enough advertising to make things work. So they have gone to this model where they may recommend a product, and they may have done so independently. But if you follow the link from that website, they end up getting payment of some kind from the company that where you buy the product. So if you click through here to Amazon, Amazon would then give BuzzFeed a particular, I don't know, whatever agreement they've made, a percentage of the sales for that product. Now, the New York Times does that with its Wirecutter section. On Wirecutter, it makes recommendations. It's sort of like Consumer Reports, and that it does a lot of vetting of products and then makes recommendations on it. But then from that, we'll say, here, you can link out to it, and we'll get a percentage of that profit. Were you going to say something, Jack? Did somebody have a question? Oh, you're muted. Jack, I can't hear you.
No, I just I just muted to make sure there would be no background noise.
Oh, okay. Okay. So it's just something, this is not disreputable. This is not bad per se. It's just something to keep in mind. That this is a way that organizations are making money, and you may not realize that, but when you're clicking through from that site to a site where you're buying something, the referring site is often getting some sort of a payment for doing that. Now, one of the reasons that advertising for publications has diminished so much is because of search. And that's where Google has been the primary recipient of all this. I mean, Google, its search advertising has been down since generative AI has spread over the last 18 months. But it still makes up, I think, a very large percentage of Google's income. Now, when you do a search, you'll get what Google says is an unbiased result based on a whole lot of calculations. And I'll get into that in a minute. But you'll also get a lot of here, if you look for it right up top, on this case, I just searched for mattresses in Kansas City. All right, well, right away, I'm getting something called sponsored content. So if you're not paying attention, it's very easy for that to get lost because, oh, here are some right up top, and a lot of them have sales. Again, it doesn't mean that they're bad. It just means that these are all sponsored, that these companies have paid Google for placement, so that when someone clicks on these, it's usually a particular per thousand views of this ad that they will get revenue from it, or that they will pay Google for it and for that kind of placement. This is on a search. Nearly every search engine does that, unless the ones say like DuckDuckGo or Mozilla or some others that are that don't accept advertising. But otherwise they're run by their, I mean, they make their money from advertising. So you'll see it there. Even on, let's say, I mean, I'm using this, I'll go on another one, but you can look on this one. If I go into the map, increasingly that with the search, there'll be a map. Where can you find that? And then you'll see the sponsored content up here, along with, okay, here are the places where you could buy mattresses in Kansas City that Google has listed. Now, these are listings. These are not necessarily everyone. These are ones that have created accounts with Google so that Google knows that this is a mattress organization or someplace that sells mattresses or widgets or whatever it is. They have an account. They may not have to, they may not necessarily be paying for it, but this is the equivalent of what would have been a classified ad or what would have been an ad in the phone book, that the company is putting its information on Google so that when it's searching, when you're searching on Google, that you're getting their information as well. So some of them are sponsored, some of them are not. And it's really the way that Google places search results is it's complicated. Nobody really knows exactly how it's done, but it has a lot to do with keywords, with linking from other pages, with things that Google determines are reputation, good reputation that they try to push up in the search results, but not necessarily. Now, this also happens in, let's say you're using Google Maps or another Maps program. There is something called promoted pins. And the promoted pin is just the idea, it's the same thing that a company may pay Google to show you its ad or to show you its listing when you're putting in a particular search. They're doing the same thing when you're putting information in Google Maps. So in this case, what did I put in here? I think I was looking for painters or renovators or repair companies, something like that, that I put in Lawrence. And this is what I got. Now, are any of these promoted? I don't know for sure, but here's what I put in for. I put in something. I'm looking for painting for renovation, which it gave me those, but it also is giving me the Radisson Country Inn and Suites. It's giving me Hy-Vee. It's giving me Dillon's and Walmart. I don't know for sure, but I would guess that those are promoted. That for whatever reason, I mean, for whatever reason, I mean, some in some cases they may just show up because they're popular areas, and it helps locate other businesses. But my guess is that in some cases, at least, that those are promoted so that they're showing up so that you see them and keep them in mind when with whatever shopping you're doing. Again, this is something, this was another, I think this is one that I did with Microsoft Bing search. And it says ad, but you really have to look at it. And Google has been making it more difficult, I think, by its identification. It will now say, it may say ad here, but it will also say web sometimes. I don't know whether any of those are here or not in the searches I had. I guess not. It will say web along there too. Web just means that this is a web search. Ad means that it's just what it's saying, that it is an advertisement. So it's trying to be transparent. But at the same time, it's easy to start sort of blocking out these little notches that are there next to the search results. What I find is that depending on the search engine that I'm using, I often block out what's at the top and what's at the bottom and go toward the middle because that's where the real search results are. Not always, and it's depending on the kinds of searches that you're doing. But if you're doing a search for drugstores or something like that, you're going to get a lot of ads. And so you have to, if that's where you want to go and Walmart is it, that's great. It's right there for you, but just recognize that it's an ad. Beyond that, this is something that has been popped up in the last month that I just wanted to make people aware of. The Miami Chronicle. There's the Chicago Chronicle. There's the Kansas City Post. And almost all of them, I mean, this one say originated in 1906, but if you really read it, it says title originated in 1906, right here. Yes, there was a Kansas City Post in 1906, but now there's a website. There's something called the US News. And if you look, you can go and I pulled these up. I started doing some investigation because I wanted to look deeper into this. Russia has been creating these sites in cities across the country. There are dozens of them. And sometimes they have legitimate news associated with them. But they'll also be, it will be slipping things in to promote the Kremlin, to promote Russia's point of view. And you don't know what's coming from where. So it's really important, again, to know your news source. If you're just pulling from what a search engine gives you, or what pops up on a phone or something like that, it may start feeding you some of these things that sound legitimate because they're actually pulling from newspapers that once existed, but have now been appropriated by the Kremlin, and which is creating all of these fake news sites in hopes of drawing people in and providing just enough real things that people start to take them seriously. Now, how do you know with this? One way with something like the Miami Chronicle is a pretty good example, because I went to this site. The first thing that I was looking for is an about page that would tell me who's publishing this, where is it coming from, who are the people involved. And if you look, this is from the bottom of the page. There's nothing. It's not giving me any options whatsoever to look deeper into who owns this site and where the information might be coming from, what the site is about, what particular things it's trying to accomplish. It just says Miami Chronicle, and then it gives you things like this. Some of the other sites associated with that are also linked to the Kremlin have some additional information, but they still have this same look to them. And I think that's another thing that you can kind of pay attention to. If some of the sites that you're looking for, I mean, these even have some of the same stories across them. They're sharing stories. They have the same web company that's creating the site, so they all look pretty much the same. So that's one way to look at or to tell sometimes. But again, you have to be careful and to really stay with the sources that you know are trustworthy, and that you can then start looking behind and asking, all right, where are they getting the information? How do I know this is real? This happens with social media as well. If you have a chance at some point, I would go to a place called, it's just the website is spotthetroll.org. It's created by Clemson University Media Forensics Hub. And it's a little game that you can go through and see whether you can identify which of the people on social media are real and which are fake. And I'll give you an example. It looks like people are still writing it down. So Spot, SPOTTHEPROLL.org is where this is. And you'll see profiles like this, all of which are fake. Often, and I'll give you a list here in a minute of things to look for. Interestingly, they often put young women in their 20s in these profiles. If you look, they rarely have any personal information. The posts on there have no personal information. Sometimes they are, in this case, Nevada peace officers, Thin Blue Line and Blue Lives Matter, let's support our heroes together. That's not a real organization. Now, how would you know that? You wouldn't necessarily, but there are some ways to tell. And this is, again, from the Clemson Media Forensics Hub. So if you're looking at a social media site, there's no personal information, nothing that would give you a chance to say, huh, I wonder if that person's real. What do I know about them? How might I be able to find something out about them? There's no way to do that on that site. There's nothing in a profile. They never talk about who they are, what they do, and that the posts that they put on social media are almost always political. And they're almost always either very much in favor of something or very much against. They're very polarized. And it's not necessarily one perspective or the other. It's not necessarily left and it's not necessarily right. What they're trying to do, what the Russian government has been trying to do, is really create this polarization in American society. So that's, you know, these are some of the things that they do. These are bigger in swing states, not surprisingly. Again, they share the polemics. They're really trying to create disgust and make people angry about things. They often have young, attractive women posting, which is very, you know, it's a very interesting approach. Now, there's also something that's called digital blackface, which is when someone is posing as a person of color. I mean, they have some sort of a photo that makes it look like they are. Again, it's trying to draw you in and to make it fit with what the posts are and why they're posting in particular ways. You're going to be talking next week about phones. And I've talked with some about news, web, social media, email. This is something I got via email a while back. And I use Microsoft Teams every day. I'm constantly on there. And I use it so much in so many different ways that it's easy to lose track of where of what I'm doing and where. And so I got this message and it says, oh, here's a survey, and you filled out the survey and you won an iPhone. And I thought, huh, I don't remember taking the survey, but I do so many things like this that it's certainly possible. So I made the mistake and I clicked through on it. Now, it sent me to Microsoft Teams, which is a portal for messaging, usually within a company or sharing information within a company, in my case at KU. So it didn't create any problems there, other than when you click on something like that, sometimes it can create send malicious data to your device, whatever that device is. But it will also tell the company that this is an actual email address and that there is a person there who is maybe a little bit gullible. So they'll keep coming back and coming back and coming back and sending things to you. It's the same thing with the phone scams, and I won't get in deep into the phone because if you're going to talk about it next week, but what I tell my parents is if you don't know the number, don't answer. And it's just, and I know this, and I know what it's like when the phone's ringing, and it's like we're just trained. It's like we got to answer the phone. We got to stop that ringing. We got to stop that ringing. Well, the reason you can just let it ring is that companies are just using generated numbers. They don't have a name with a number often. They just have lists of numbers, and they're often calling 6, 8, 10 people at a time and hoping that somebody picks up. And if somebody picks up, that number is then flagged as a real number and then is back into their system and will stay within their system because they know that you're a real person there rather than a number that may not be used right now. So it's just something to keep in mind. I get fooled too. And I mean, I feel like I'm pretty suspicious of things. And yet, I fall for it. And in this case, I read too quickly. One of the ways to spot fakes is that they're often misspelled. There are often misspellings. And in this case, it does say important, Doug Ward, you are one of the winner in our January contest. So if I had looked more closely, I would have seen that. And that's usually a tell that there's something off there because the company, if it's a legitimate company that's doing this, it is being reviewed by many people before it goes out. So it's very unlikely that a legitimate company will send something out like that with that kind
Doug,
of information. Yeah.
we have a quick question. It's a
Sure.
really good one that I think happens to all of us. Mike Wallace says, I get a lot of junk mail that looks like, for example, Home Depot, but the email address is
Yeah.
something that isn't.
Yep.
He blocks the email and moves it to the junk folder, but he wants to know, how do I block these without opening the email?
Well, you can go and usually, depending on the email client that you're using, you can often look at it and you can see it. And if you do a right click on it, and it will then bring up a menu. And then often within that menu, you can say, this is spam, or block the sender, or something like that. So you can do that. You could also, on your email, it will give you options for a preview of those messages that will show up so that you can see it, but you haven't clicked on it.
Yeah.
So that helps you look
Right.
at that message a little bit deeper, and then you can go and do the right click and send it into the spam folder, and block the message. That's the way that I usually do it. Now, clicking on it itself is not necessarily going to hurt you at all. The problem is if you're clicking on a link within it. If you're clicking on a link within it and it's a live link, it may then trigger something that puts some sort of a virus on your computer, or it may send you to some sort of a troll website where they're trying to gather information from you. So just opening the email message itself is usually not going to cause a problem. It's just when you click on the material in that message.
Okay, so then he follows up with, do I delete the email? Do I move it to junk mail? How do I keep it from showing up
I
again?
would move it. I would move it to junk mail, and I would, let's see if I can show you. Let me see what I've got here that I could see if I can pull up my own email for you. Let me stop here. See if I can pull up Gmail. And
Well, he's doing that, Mike. I will tell you, when you delete it, that won't normally stop it. If you put it in junk mail, at least if they keep sending it, it'll go constantly. It'll just continue to go to junk mail, and you don't have to deal with it and just clean up your junk mail on a regular basis. but deleting it doesn't necessarily keep them from stopping. And in many cases, you'll also notice when you unsubscribe that, especially when it's something like this, that is something you really don't want, if you check your sent mail, half the time the unsubscribes don't go through. So you have to also be a little careful about that.
Yeah.
You have to make
Oh,
sure the
crap.
unsubscribe actually went through no matter what it says, because I get a huge number of unsubscribes that get returned as no such email.
Yes, that's
But if you
right.
hit the unsubscribe, you're essentially letting them know you're real.
Well, you are. That's true. And I think it depends. If it's a legitimate company and you unsubscribe, they will unsubscribe you. If it's not, then you're what you want to do, and here's what I would do. And so if I right click on this is Gmail, and it gives me the option, I can move it to spam. And if I move it to spam, that will then mark it, and anything else from that company or that sender should go to spam. You could also, let's see, in I don't know, use Gmail that much. So you can do tags on it as well. And I'm sorry, I don't use Gmail all that much anymore. So I don't know, other than I know that's the way that I would do it, is to make sure that it's labeled and to send it to, or to move it to the spam folder.
That's what other members are saying too, Mike, that they do that as well.
That would be the way that I would do it. Because if you just delete it, deleting that message is not going to stop them. If you get it into spam so that the email client recognizes that sender as spam, then it will automatically send it into spam. Now, the problem, and I have this problem, that some of these companies will create, they may send it from a different account every time they send you one, and they may send you something every day or several times a day. They just create Google accounts and just go over and over and over. So in a case like that, what you want to do is to look for that suffix so that this is at wherever it is, and then you can set up a filter on it so that when the email client recognizes from at dougscam.com, no matter what's at the beginning, it will send it into your spam folder. And unfortunately, I'm not set up to really show you that. I don't have it at my fingertips, so I can't show you exactly how to do that. But it's pretty easy to set things up like that as well.
And just as a quick follow-up, if you have specific problems like that and have some concerns, and you can either call in, or if you have a laptop or a phone, take it in to the library, to the tech desk, make an appointment with them, and they can walk through all of that with you, because Jim's worked really hard with his people on this specific subject. And they're very glad to help you with your specific phone, your specific, whether it's Gmail or AOL or whatever it is that you're having a problem with. They can usually help you. So don't forget about using the tech desk at the library.
Yeah, that's great. That's a great way to do it. And Rita, I don't know. You're asking about things, about ads and things on Facebook. There's so much junk that comes across there. And that's not a platform that I'm not an expert there. And I really can't tell you. I don't use it. I mean, partly for that reason, there's just so much like that that comes across. So I don't know whether there's a way to get rid of that kind of material on Facebook or not. And yes, you talked about unsubscribe, and I do unsubscribe when I can, and it just depends. Some places, if it's a really shady company, they will use that to say, ah, now we've got a live one, and we'll keep sending to you. So that's when the spam filter can be very helpful. I'm going to sh So go ahead.
I was just going to mention, I've run into a couple of things. Maybe you can expand on this. There are sometimes in unsubscribe multiple options. So if you hit the first unsubscribe, you will unsubscribe from that company, but the parent company has 27 other companies. But in many cases, if you go further down, scroll a little bit, there's an unsubscribe from all or unsubscribe from, and they give the name of the parent company, and that can sometimes seem to help, I think. I'm not sure, but that's, I
It
found that.
can. Yeah, it can. And that's a good point, because if you go to the you do the, an unsubscribe, and some companies will give you all these options, and they'll say, well, you really do you really want to unsubscribe? Are you sure? We hate to lose you. And yes, I just want to unsubscribe. And then you get to the page and it may have 40 different options. Well, do you want to unsubscribe to this? And do you want to unsubscribe to that? And often it's only till you get to the bottom that it says unsubscribe from everything. I want to share a video that's only 3 minutes long. It's fun. And I'm hoping that you'll be able to hear it.
Okay, if you
This
share
is.
it, you have to click. There's a thing to click for the sound before you
Okay.
share it. So I'm not,
All right,
I
let's
don't have that
see.
in front of me, but make sure you click that before I do it, or there won't be any sound.
Ah, yeah, okay, got it.
Okay,
Thank you.
great.
Thank you for reminding me of
I've been
that.
there and done that.
All right. So this is a YouTube video, and
A few people have tried it. Nobody has ever managed to get anywhere close to what we got like today.
You have to believe you can do these things. It's not like impossible.
There's been a few people that have been like sort of following us. It's
me, my boots, and we're gonna make it.
I definitely think it's gonna be the next big thing. The Liquid Mountaineering is actually Ulf's brainchild.
New sport was not existing before.
You have to run very fast on the water.
I mean, obviously the first step was the most important one. When we like discovered, oh my God, Jesus, we're going one step, we're going two steps, we're going three steps. We're discovering it as we go along.
While we're still on land, we tried to get up really speed. Soon we touched the water. We tried to get like a sewing machine.
It's not straight into the water, you know.
In a curve, in a slight curve.
And by that bend, you're actually not allowing yourself to sink into the water, and you want to keep that skimming sensation going as long as you can.
Bonjour.
What gets us those extra steps are these shoes.
The original equipment where it first all started was the equipment that would help repel water. We found some shoes by mistake, actually.
Totally water repellent. It's like water off a duck's back. It takes actually a lot of practice, a lot of focus. I think if you don't actually believe that you're gonna walk on that water, it's not gonna happen for you.
Go, 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 go.
Working on a jet ski system, obviously that pulls us into the water with a bit more speed.
Be with yourself, believe in it. It's not about the miracle, it's just go for it.
Try to do it. If you fall down, try again.
People want you to think in a certain way, and this sport actually allows you to push your horizons further. It's not boxing you in and saying that's what you are. You're just like, you're moving past it all.
I love that video, and I love it because it's brilliantly done, and it is an ad. That's what's so fun about it. And if you let me share my screen again with if I can get back to my slides. Oh, come on. I've got too many windows open. There we go. This is an ad for a shoe company called High Tech. And you can see, I mean, all the little tells are there. They're saying, oh, we were trying this, and then we found this shoe that repelled water, and that was just the perfect thing. Why I like it so much is the way that it was set up, and that it starts by, oh, look, we tried it. We just have these guys, and this is actually how they created the video. They just found these guys off the street and then paid them to do this video. And they were trying this, and oh my gosh, it didn't work. It wasn't so easy. And then it shows you, well, maybe it is, because then they're showing you can skip a stone on the water, and you're thinking, huh. Well, then they have the Jesus statue walk on water there hanging from there, and they show the shoes, and then he's saying, okay, there's a technique to it. And then they've got the boats out there where they're pulling it like water skis. It was an ad made to go viral, and it did. I mean, it got lots of interest because it's so well done, but it's an ad at the core. It's an ad for the shoe company, and what they're trying to do is generate views and just get the name out there and say, oh, people are looking at this, and then they're seeing the name and the shoes and kind of equating it with that. It's hard to go viral now, but it happens, but it can do that. Another thing to keep in mind is product placement. When you are watching television shows, when you're watching movies, in the original Top Gun, the sales of Ray-Ban sunglasses skyrocketed after Tom Cruise wore them in there. You'll see Nikon cameras, the phones, Starbucks, particular cars, Taco Casa. This hit a peak, and Jurassic World, the movie, was one that just got panned because of there were so many product placements in it for Starbucks, for Pandora, for just all kinds of different products, that there was actually a parody movie or a parody video made of it because of all of the different products that were shown in there.
Real quick, because we're starting to get close to the end.
Yeah.
Ellen mentioned something, and I think it's a really good question on unsubscribe. If they ask for your email, she said, I never get it because I assume they already had it since they sent me something. Is that the correct way to do it? Should you just put that into spam and not try to unsubscribe if part of it is giving your email again?
Either way, I've had it drives me nuts when I'd go to unsubscribe and they say put your email address in there. And these are legitimate sites that will do that. So sometimes it's real. That's just the way that it's set up. But if you have any doubt about it, then I would send it to the spam folder. Absolutely.
Okay, and I don't want to jump ahead of anything, but as we're getting close, there's one other thing I wanted to hit on, and that is, and I'm not sure if this is within your expertise, but that is certified or approved by advertising. So I was in the shoe business most of my life for about 45 years, and
Yeah.
I would get people. We were making nursing shoes, and the American Podiatric Association wrote us, and we can get approval and certify your shoes. Our shoes were not podiatric shoes. They were comfortable shoes. They were made for
Right.
wearing for 12 hours. They were all those things, but they're not podiatric shoes. And for a mere $35,000,
Right.
we could have their certification put on our boxes.
Yeah.
which was basically either a lobbyist or just a money-making project. And
Yeah.
that's, I just wanted to mention, because that's another sponsored kind of thing that you have, you know, is Crest, you know, which is approved by the American Dental Association, really tested by them, or is it just a funded organization for lobbying?
Right. Yeah, there's a lot of that. You'll see sports is really big on this. You'll say that there is the official cereal of the Final Four, or this is the official shoe of the NBA. I mean, there's just, what does that mean? It really means nothing, usually. It just means that somebody is being paid, or somebody has paid for that sort of a promotion to be associated with that. I mean, KU does that. KU now has a contract with Pepsi. So it has a Pepsi contract, so it can sell only Pepsi products on campus. Can't sell Coke products anymore. Did have a contract with Coke, and then they changed it because Coke Pepsi gave them more money. So there's all kinds of things like that.
Okay. Are there, as we're getting down to the last 2 or 3 minutes, any other questions anybody would like to ask? Because I know Doug probably could go in for another hour, and we could probably learn stuff for another hour, but I want to respect everybody's time. Okay. I just want to make sure everybody has a chance to type or to unmute and ask, if whichever they want to do. Okay. Yeah. Well, as we get to the end, I'm sorry, go ahead.
I have a question. There's some sites that I routinely read, and when I'm reading the articles, there's posted ads throughout the article. Mm-hmm. And these are Google ads, and they post it sometimes right over the content. And you can't, if you click on it, then it says, why do you not want this? And then they try to, but it's almost impossible to get rid of them. And sometimes it blocks the content, you can't even read the article. I don't know if there's any way to get rid of them.
There are some ad blockers that you can use on browsers. And I use several different ad blockers on mine. And that works often, but it also will run into problems because it will block legitimate content too. And if you go onto a site where it is asking you, or will tell you, you're using an ad blocker, we can't show you any of the content. So that can be a problem. Let me see, pull up what I can tell you what I've been using. There's one called AdBlock. I mean, that's a pretty easy one. AdBlock. That's a pretty good one. That's one that I use. There's another one called Privacy Test that I use, and another one called Protect My Choices. So if you're opting out of different things, then you can, that it will make sure that you're not, that it will not revert back, because all of the websites have cookies on them that are basically tracking what you're clicking on and what you're reading and what you're doing. So it's, some of those blockers can be helpful in that regard. Or you could go to a browser like DuckDuckGo, which then blocks things automatically.
All right, thanks.
Anything else before we close out? How do you manage cookies? Oh, that's a short answer.
There are some plugins for that. Let me give you the name of one that I use now. I mean, cookies are not all bad. The cookies help keep some information so that if you go back to that website, you don't have to keep filling in everything all of the time. Or it recognizes you as a subscriber if you're a subscriber. I go in every so often and just delete cookies that I know come from various advertising companies that I don't want them following me around. There's a plug-in, and I can't remember whether it's called cookie crusher or cruncher or something like that, that will automatically, when you close a website, will delete the cookies for that website. Now, again, that can be good or bad, because if you go back to that site, if it's something that you're going back to regularly, it will not remember you and you're going to have to enter your information in every time. I know it's late. I'm going to show you one more thing, because it just, as this came up, I think it's worth, I think it's worth sharing. If I can bring something up real quick that does this. I've deleted everything.
While he's looking for that real quick, Shelley asked, how do you keep cookies from some sites but lose the rest? You can go back, you can eliminate all cookies, but you can delete specific cookies. And we're not going to have time to go through that, but that is something Jim can help you with at the tech desk if you need some help on that. So you can either call in or make an appointment to chat with one of the people in his thing. But you can eliminate specific cookies, and you can choose not to accept cookies from specific sites. I'm sorry. Go ahead, Doug.
Absolutely. This is going to be hard to see, but when you click on something, say from email, anything that you do, when that, it will usually give you, then it will embed basically an ad within there that will, that is tracking you, that is share, telling you that this came from a particular site. If you look anything, anytime you're looking at a URL, it's usually beyond, if you see something where there is a slash and then a question mark, and you'll see all this, there's a lot of information. Sometimes it will just go on far longer than the actual address. See, I can delete that, and that's just tracking information. Now, I have a plugin on my browser called Clear URLs that deletes some of that. It's not malicious. It's just, for me, it's annoying because I share a lot of web addresses. And if you get a web address from someone and it's about five lines long, that's the reason. It's because it has been, has gone through, and it has that tracking information on it, so that you could take the rest of that tracking information off and leave a much smaller URL that's easier to share.
Okay. I'm afraid we're going to have to call it quits for this evening. There's a lot more that could be shared.